Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Mosby's Men by John H. Alexander, narrated by Norman Dietz. This performance is copyrighted 1988 by Recorded Books, Incorporated. John Singleton Mosby was practicing law in his home state of Virginia when the Civil War broke out, and after joining the cavalry, he rose to the rank of colonel during the early fighting in the Shenandoah Valley. Later, he worked as a scout for Jeb Stuart, and in December 1862 began organizing his own battalion of independent cavalry that ultimately grew to 800 men. Mosby, who weighed all of 125 pounds in full riding gear, practiced the art of guerrilla warfare, operating mostly in northern Virginia. Mosby's raiders, armed with revolvers, the saber being rejected as too noisy and ineffectual, operated mostly behind enemy lines, creating ambushes and surprise night attacks, capturing dispatches, officers, supplies, and Yankee gold, and generally being so successful a nuisance that the Union Army was obliged to strengthen its forces on an area away from the front lines. The friendly local population helped hide his supplies and men, and though there was a high price on his head, he repeatedly eluded his would-be captors. As a result, the area of his operations, especially the Loudoun Valley, was repeatedly ravaged in retaliation. All in all, Mosby figured he had kept 30,000 men from joining Grant's army, and it's probable that his activities delayed the end of the war by at least 6 months. John H. Alexander rode with Mosby for a year, beginning in the spring of 1864. But it wasn't until more than 40 years later, in 1907, that he published this memoir. And now, Mosby's Men.
This book doesn't purport to be a history of Mosby's command in the sense of being a full and accurate account of its operations. It's a narrative of what I saw of the men and their doings, as they impressed me at the time, and as my memory reproduces them now. Many of their exploits, perhaps their finest performances, I neither participated in nor saw. When I've had occasion to refer to incidents outside of my personal knowledge, it's indicated. The extent and character of my information is also indicated. It's very rarely that two men see the same thing in exactly the same way. And of all subjects upon which eyewitnesses differ, it seems that upon a fight, a battle, there's the most frequent and pronounced variance. So it's quite probable that some of our comrades may remember certain occurrences differently from the way I remember them. All that I claim is that they're here reproduced with absolute fidelity to my memory of them. And there's nothing between the lids of this book which, in that sense, isn't strictly true. I have in no instance consciously lapsed into fiction or colored an incident in the faintest degree. In these pages, the reader has Mosby's men exactly as I had the privilege of knowing them, and as I now understand them after a lifetime's observation of men and things. Chapter 1. A General View of Mosby's Men. My friend and comrade, Joseph Bryan of Company D, now of the Richmond Times-Dispatch, used to say that he never indulged in war reminiscences except to auditors who had themselves had experiences, because he feared that his reputation for veracity wouldn't stand the strain. If he, who's recognized as the very soul of truth, albeit he's vested with the liberty which is accorded to newspapermen, should feel such sensitiveness, I may well hesitate to commit myself to posterity in the following pages. The grounds of my apprehensions are that actions which were natural and mere matters of course under conditions which then prevailed would be impossible now. And viewed from the standpoint of these piping times of peace, they seem fantastic and incredible. It's hard to get the right perspective on them and make due allowance for difference in times and circumstances. The great poet advised, "If you would view fair Melrose right, go view it by the pale moon's light." And so, there's a certain light, sentimental, artificial if you choose, with which either narrator or hearer must invest these scenes of long ago if one would see the deeds and the actors just as they were. To those of us whose experiences cover that period, memory brings back the tender grace of the days that are dead. We must trust those of the rising generation to imagine that atmosphere of romance and chivalry which then pervaded the land, and in which only were possible the deeds which I shall attempt to recount. The part which Mosby and his men played in the great war between the states was interesting, striking, and in many respects picturesque. Of the brilliancy and value of their achievements, I leave the historian to speak. And he'll find abundance of material for his work stored up for him by their enemies in the records of the rebellion. I shall attempt to present to you merely some pictures of the partisans in everyday life, showing how they lived and their relation to the people among whom they lived, the things they did and how they did them, so that you may judge what manner of men these were who've gained for themselves a peculiar place in history and song and story. Of course, my first object is to entertain you, and I've culled from quite a mass of material just those things which I think will please you most. At the same time, I hope to present the facts so as to lead you to true conceptions of my old companions in arms, and to vindicate them from the unjust charges under which they've rested in some quarters, of being a band of ruffians and desperados. I confess that I had some such opinion of them myself, and when I left my home in the Shenandoah Valley in the spring of 1864, it was with the purpose of enlisting in the Black Horse Cavalry, among whom I had many friends. But as I passed through Mosby's Confederacy, I tarried among these bold spirits, and the hearts that they bore and the tales that they told won me to their side. Of all the years that have come to me, the one which I rode with them brought to me the most of which I am proud. Rough riders they were, as indeed they had need to be. For 300 or 400 men to preserve their organization for years in an open country within 50 miles of their enemy's great capital and escape capture by the armies which surrounded them and constantly traversed their territory. For them to dispose themselves so as to be at any given time, to all intents and purposes, at every point on a circle about them, and keep 40,000 of their enemies back from the front, actively and anxiously engaged in watching them. All this required pretty lively equestrian exercise. The most active among them had several horses apiece, and their only respite from the saddle for days and days would be at the bivouac and short halts on the march. 50 miles a day was no unusual ride, and I've known them to make infinitely better time than that for short distances under the pressure of circumstances. The same party that prowled with Underwood among the Federal camps in Fairfax one night would be galloping with Russell among Sheridan's wagon trains in the valley before the rising of the second sun. The scout that crouched in the spray of the great falls and assured himself that all's quiet along the Potomac tonight, tomorrow would dream of home and loved ones on a grassy bank while the Shenandoah lulled him with her murmurings to her kindred stars. Desperate fighters, some of them were, but this too was largely of necessity. Real hard fighting was often the only alternative to disaster. Some there were who loved the bounding of barbed steeds that bore them to the fray, the grim, tense hush, the war cry sounding, the headlong charge, the dark melee. But I believe that none of them pursued fighting as a healthful recreation. While waiting in position for a fight, I've known the best of them to sicken and tremble with nervousness, caused not so much, I think, by fears for themselves as anxiety about the work that was before them. Killing men is a painful business, and to sit quietly in cold blood and contemplate it is a fearsome thing. But at the first shot fired, one could see the whole line brace itself and with the wild hurrah that sounded a charge, the thin veneering over men's native savagery would crack and burst. There's no thrill like that which strains the soul in the onward rush of battle. No ecstasy on earth like that with which one sees the foe shiver, break, and run. Of course, men lost their company manners in the crush and tug of a hand-to-hand fight, and human life was cheap. I believe Ben Palmer was the only man of whom I ever heard who could preserve the amenities to the point of killing a foe with apologies for his rudeness, and going through a captive in the graceful form of a request for whatever surplus federal funds he might have about his person. In the delirium bred by the pistol crack and the smell of powder smoke and the sight of blood, I've seen the gentlest men do desperate deeds, things of which they were incapable in their civilized condition. Let brave men judge each other about these matters. I believe, too, that Mosby's men often affected daredeviltry for the same reason that some folks nowadays assume honesty. It was the best policy. We banked heavily on the maxim that the boldest front oftenest wins the fight. And all of our tactics were pervaded by a distinct calculation of the awful odds there are usually in the favor of the fellow who is hunting for a fight. The presumption is that he's fixed for it. So, when one was to come off, we always sought the initiative, not only because that gave us the choice of time and position, but for the stronger reason, as dear old Harry Hatcher used to put it, boys, everything depends upon getting the bulge on 'em. We acted under David Harum's version of the Golden Rule, do unto the other fellow as he would do unto you, and do it first. If a charge was to be made, we didn't go into it in serried ranks and with orderly approach as if to impress the enemy with our awful dignity. But each man realized that the shorter the time from the start to the finish, the less the danger was, and would clap spurs to his horse, often throw the bridle rein on its neck, and with pistol in each hand bend every energy to getting there and making himself as numerous and influential as possible on the way. Of course, nothing ever resisted such onsets, not even infantry behind a fence as at Rectortown, nor dismounted cavalry in a blockhouse as at Warrenton Junction. An infantryman captured in such a charge was asked what made them break. Why, he said, you fellows came so quick we hadn't time to think. And besides, if we'd shot the men off, the crazy horses would have run over us. The story went that Colonel Mosby called Lieutenant Hatcher to book for making that charge, but the brave, bluff fellow's defense was, well, Colonel, you told me to make a demonstration to get them from behind that fence. And if that didn't mean charge 'em, I don't know what it did mean. You see, such operations were against all tactics, and the very insanity of the thing, apparent or real, I've never determined which, ensured its success. And I think this was true of many things that the Rangers did. Major Forbes complained bitterly of our irregular treatment of his crack California battalion. He had formed his well-appointed and thoroughly disciplined veterans in magnificent battle array, on a hill in an open field, and awaited our attack with all the confidence of the proficient commander of an invincible machine. His program was that we should charge him in front up the hill in solid column and receive the volleys from his drilled platoons, a procedure the exigencies demanded and the books authorized. But we weren't out illustrating Hardee's tactics that afternoon, and our helter-skelter race for his front put our killers into his ranks, and we got down to smashing his beautiful machine before it was in working order. The major insisted, with tears in his eyes, that this was unprofessional. Well, maybe it was. The truth is, we were an undisciplined lot. During the 12 months of my service, I learned but four commands. Fall in and count off by fours, march, close up, and charge. There was another movement with which we were not altogether unfamiliar, an order technically known as the skedaddle, but I never heard the command given. The Rangers seemed to know instinctively when that movement was appropriate, and never waited for the word. And I want to tell you that this is a highly strategic movement, which I've never known to be appreciatively discussed by any military critic. You see, when the Yankees broke, they would always run in a bunch, and all we had to do was to follow and pick them up. For instance, out of the California battalion, of 300 which we broke up at Mount Zion, only 5 or 6 escaped. When we routed Blazer's 150 at Myerston, only 2, according to the war records, ever reported for duty. But when we found it necessary to leave the scene of action, each man worked out his own salvation and struck for home and fireside by his own particular path. We dissolved like the mist before their very eyes visibly and left them nothing to follow. Perhaps the successful execution of these movements, or any execution save utter demoralization, was possible only with men of our peculiar training. When not under the immediate command of the officers, each man was his own commander, commissary, quartermaster, and everything else. He was dependent upon his own resources for supplies and his own wits for safety. In the enemy's country, too, such a life made him watchful, alert, and self-reliant. It developed in the men a strong individuality which made them feel personally responsible for results and made them more than mere automata to be maneuvered by commands of officers. They seldom lost their heads, and when thrown upon their own resources were usually equal to the emergency. These same conditions also demanded that the men should be expert in the use of their weapons. Uncle Sam's ordnance department supplied them abundantly with ammunition, and much of it was consumed in target practice. This deadly aptness with the revolver not only reacted on our men and gave them nerve and self-confidence, but it increased their efficiency and formidability to a degree that one can scarcely appreciate until he stops to think about it. It's one thing to shoot for the purpose of making smoke and noise, to shoot at random or automatically in volleys. It's an awfully different thing to shoot to kill. Believe me, a calm, cool, dead shot behind a Colt's revolver or a Spencer repeating rifle has more moral force than a Gatling gun. The average soldier has an unconquerable prejudice against a pistol which he knows is going to hit somebody when it goes off, and he just will not go to meet it. You must reckon with this characteristic when you undertake to account for some of the exploits of Mosby's men, for it was an important one. It will explain the extraordinarily large number of the enemy killed and wounded, as compared with the number of prisoners taken, a fact which has been urged as proof of our brutality. And it will enable you to understand how small squads of Rangers, over and over again, discomfited, or at least stood off, large bodies of men, even regiments. A half dozen such dead shots across a narrow defile, especially if their number were not positively discovered, could hold up a road full of Federals almost indefinitely. Allow, too, for the Federal soldier's mortal dread of decoys and ambuscades, of which he often had bitter experience, and you'll appreciate the following story of how one lone Ranger held up a whole regiment on an open turnpike in broad daylight. How he caused them to advance upon him in regular line of battle with skirmishers deployed, and finally rode away from them more or less at his ease. This young fellow was convalescing from a wound, and had so far recovered that one spring morning his fancy lightly turned to thoughts of love, and he rode down the turnpike from Middleburg to Dover to call on some ladies. Our command had gone down the same road the day before on a raid into Fairfax, and he had reason to believe that he was the only military body in the neighborhood. So, when he raised on a swell in the road to a plateau about 200 yards long and saw a file of horsemen ride onto it at the other end, there was a moment of mutual surprise. His first thought was that it was the vanguard of our own command returning. but he instinctively halted and drew his revolver. When the four horsemen dashed toward him, yelling and shooting, and others came rushing into sight, he took in the situation. He knew that a long, hard chase was before him. But as he turned his horse for the start, he concluded he'd offer a suggestion to his pursuers not to crowd him too unceremoniously. He lingered a moment until they came within pistol range and fired. One of them fell to the ground, and the other three, recognizing the force of his argument and yielding to that prejudice which I have mentioned, promptly jerked up their horses. As the ranger galloped down the hill again, and for a moment disappeared from the sight of the enemy, he recollected that his horse had cast a shoe and realized that a race on the metallic road was almost hopeless of escape. He determined to take the chances of turning into a lane which opened ahead of him, but rode for a distance of several hundred yards at an acute angle with the pike, which brought him in some degree nearer toward the enemy. As he sped across this space, sure enough, he got a broadside from a squad of carbineers who had gathered on the plateau, but safely reached the turn in the road and a hollow alongside of some woods. With a sense of safety came the determination not to leave until he ascertained something more about the number and character of the raiders. Thereupon, he rode on a hill in an adjoining field and saw the road filling with Yankees. His reappearance elicited the attention of the long-range gunners, and with a shout and a wave of his hand, he retired to another convenient body of woods. All these movements, perfectly guiltless of such design, evidently convinced the Federals that he was a decoy and that the woods were full of Mosby's men. In a short while, he had the distinction of being approached by a full regiment of Federal cavalry in magnificent battle line, with banners flying and preceded by a line of skirmishers. But this was more honor than he was looking for that morning, and under cover of the woods, he retired to surroundings more in accord with his modesty. But it has been one of the regrets of his life, he assures me, that he couldn't remain near enough to hear the remarks of his friends, the enemy, when they reached the woods and found no more serious engagement awaiting them than to frighten the birds from the bushes. But it's time that I gave you some sort of a personal introduction to the men in whose company you are asked to spend a while. They were, for the most part, young men in the very flush and prime of youth. Many of them were beardless boys whose looks were far more suggestive of the nursery than of the warpath. And I fear that not all of them were model Sunday school boys either. Most of them had run away from their homes to join Mosby. And I recollect that the thing which pleased them most was their chieftain's commendation of them when asked what in the world he did with such children. "Why," he replied, "they're the best soldiers I have. They haven't sense enough to know danger when they see it, and they'll fight anything I tell them to." But these boys were, in a very material sense, veterans before they joined the command. Reared upon the border, they had passed the most impressionable time of life amid the scenes which attended the flooding and ebbing of the tide of war about their homes. They'd become familiar with war in its darkest phases and acquainted with the enemy in his strongest and weakest points. Armies had marched and countermarched about them, battles had been fought around them, their homes had been pillaged and burnt before their eyes. Scouts and spies and deserters were their familiars. They'd become experts in running pickets and securing and conveying secret information. In short, they'd learned a whole lot of things which are not down in the standard books on the culture of youth, but which admirably fitted them for partisan warfare. Not a few of them had already made tests of their qualifications and presented themselves for enlistment already mounted and equipped with the fruits of their experiments. I recall that my own charger, a spanking fine one, was a more or less voluntary contribution from Uncle Sam. I had the distinguished honor of riding him through the streets of Warrenton with General Torbert and his staff about dusk one evening. By sunrise the next morning, we were in Mosby's Confederacy. A large number of our command were veterans from the regular army who had either served out the term of their enlistment or had become disabled for that service. And many of them had already distinguished themselves in that field. Most of our earliest officers were men from the army who, upon some occasion of service with him, had attracted Colonel Mosby's attention by their bearing, and he'd secured their transfer to him by promoting them to officers. On the other hand, many of our privates had been officers in the army, high-spirited fellows who chafed under the monotony of army life and were attracted by stories of our adventures to resign their commissions and join our ranks. And so it happened that captains were about as plentiful in our command as colonels are now in civil life. I recall two captains, Kennan and D. Shane, from the celebrated Louisiana Tigers, who joined us as privates upon the extinction of that regiment. One can hardly estimate the benefits which the discipline and experience of this class of men brought to our band of amateur soldiers. Then, too, we had some grim old sires who'd neared or passed their third score year, and whom the merciless laws of war relegated to their homes. But the ruthless hands of those who knew no laws had made their homes only dark spots of desolation, or had put upon them some deep affront that set on fire even the sluggish blood of age. These were men who had some grievous wrongs to avenge, and their implacable and unwavering hate furnished a kind of conservatism to the younger and perhaps more erratic spirits. Altogether, it was peculiarly adapted material which Providence sent to our brilliant young leader, and his wonderful genius manifested itself as much in understanding and handling his men as in recognizing and rising to the opportunities which came to him. He knew each man personally, and seemed to read him at a glance, and ascertain exactly what sort of fellow he was, and exactly what use to make of him. He mingled with his men, rode with them, slept with them, and fought side by side with them. Few members of the command had a longer list of wounds and captures than himself, and fewer still, perhaps, were responsible for more personal execution. His care against needlessly exposing them, his great skill in securing them every possible advantage.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.